My name is Chad Jones, and I am the Public Affairs Officer for U.S. Army Fort Meade.
U.S. Army Fort Meade. Don't we love Fort Meade?
Yes, we should love Fort Meade.
And we do, and they're the biggest employer in the state.
Absolutely, and more than 56,000 employees from 118 organizations. So it is a good place to be and a good time to be here.
Is it fair to say that we are becoming a cyber security headquarters for all?
Well, it is safe to say, and for sure. I mean, we are, as the home of U.S. Cyber Command, National Security Agency, Defense Information Systems Agency, and other cyber headquarters, we are absolutely the nation's center for information intelligence and cyber operations, and very much the hub for all Department of Defense work in cyber.
It's so exciting. And that's really just been in the past, what, 10 years, 15 years?
Yes, that is. I mean, we've had the NSA around for about 50 years. I think it was like 1956. And, you know, but DISA came as part of BRAC, so in 2011, and cyber stood up, you know, even after that. So it has mostly been recent in keeping up with, you know, what is basically the changing face of warfare as well. I mean, to keep up with it, and the Department of Defense has put a lot of great assets and, more importantly, people here to do that mission every day.
And it's an important mission, such an important. We're finding out more all the time how important that mission is. Tell me, Chad, about the anniversary, the big doings happening.
So, yeah, so we got our 100th anniversary. We started at Fort Meade, was established in 1917 to prepare basically as a depot for World War One. So, you know, we got our tagline from saddles to cyberspace. Back in World War One, the infantry, you know, we still moved on horses. And, you know, tanks were brand new, but we were a drop-off post for about 300,000 service members, doughboys, who this was their last stop before heading over to Europe. Talked about the NSA, and now we've got, you know, in cyber, and now we're 100 years old. So throughout the whole year, we're doing different events, getting out Anne Arundel and Howard County libraries. We're partnering with them. Also, we have, you know, we're going to have a founders picnic and things like that. And then coming up on Saturday, we have our 100th anniversary gala, where we're inviting the community to celebrate the 100-year history of Fort Meade.
Okay, I have a question for you, if I may follow up. The Doughboys.
Yeah.
Were named that because?
You know, you're going to put me on the spot.
Uh-oh.
You know, if I was really clever, I'd hike it up on my Google machine, but I thought I had something to do with their uniform.
Oh.
In regards to how they got that name. But, Yeah, and then so they came here. They took the train right into Odenton.
I thought maybe they needed to work out before they got ready for combat or
no,
something.
No, they were ready. They were ready. They were ready. Yep, I was right. It was because of the flour or pipe clay which the soldiers used to polish their white belts.
How about
that's
that?
That's why they were called Doughboys.
How about that?
You know, because, and yeah, now I've seen, and we have a lot of historic artifacts here. So I've been looking at a lot of World War One pictures.
Yeah, the museum's awesome.
Yeah, and, you know, these men and women, we were one of the first forces to really incorporate to incorporate women into the armed services as well. There was no plump or no dough. They were American heroes, and we
fit
were
for service.
Honored to be able to and establish really to ship them out so that this is their last place where they could get their final training before they headed out to Europe. And World War II, we did the same thing. But to the tune of about 4 million service members came through Fort Meade before they headed out to fight in the war.
So the mission has really changed for Fort Meade.
Yes, the mission has gone really from saddles to cyberspace. I mean, right after World War One, then Lieutenant Colonel Patton and Major Eisenhower helped develop the tank corps right after World War One. And then you go through and how that revolutionized battle at that point. Then you come in the 50s when the National Security Agency and everything came in, you know, really expanded the use of intelligence, information, you know, the way that all Department of Defense media is handled is also done here. And then obviously, as we talked about earlier, the cyber war of today, how that has changed. All the things from the past are still absolutely necessary and absolutely, you know, still vibrant parts of the Army today. But it is very interesting how Fort Meade seems to get on the cusp of these things right when they start. Mm-hmm. And has been a place where the Department of Defense has allowed these type of assets to be developed for future use.
It's got to be something to do with proximity to D.C., don't you think?
You know, I can't say 100% for sure, but it would certainly make a lot of sense. You notice that also a lot with a couple other forts like Fort Belvoir, where we're more like a office park in that we pile a bunch of different non-connected agencies together, in part so they, I would assume that the short trip to the Pentagon probably has a lot to do with that.
Mm-hmm. Well, tell me about, as far as the particulars, where people can get information, if they want to just come on base and know about the best times to do it, what the protocols are for security, what they need to have for identification, give me some of the nitty-gritty.
Yeah, so especially for the installation, now security, you do not just get to stop by the fort. So the most important reason is to have a valid reason to come onto the installation. And then when you do that, you will go in, you have to have your driver's license, and you go in and you can get basically you have to go through a security check in our visitor control center. About a 5 to 10 minute process where, you know, you figure out what's your purpose, who's going to be your sponsor on base, so on and so forth. That's just for day-to-day non-CAT card interaction. Coming up for the gala, if you go to the Fort Meade website, www.ftmeade.army.mil, and you will see the link for the gala, and that includes process procedures in our visitor control center, which is normally closed on Saturdays, will actually be open from 5 to 6:30 Saturday afternoon to help process people who are coming.
The website, I've got fortmeade.army.mil.
Yes, www.ftmeade.army.mil.
Okay, so if people want to get more information about security processes coming, and the list of events I'm sure is there, and what's free, there might be costs associated with some things, and just general information on if they want to make a visit to the Fort Meade Museum.
Absolutely, they can absolutely do that. I would just say outside of the gala, which is a paid event, but it's $85 where proceeds are going directly back to family morale, to basically military families, but you get a heavy hors d'oeuvres, which from what I understand is a lot of food from Bruce Chris. We got three different bands playing, and each of the rooms in our club will be decorated in period, basically to give you a visualization of what life was like here on the fort for the 100 years.
So people need to get all dolled up if they're going to go to the gala.
You know, yes, not quite tuxedo, though those will be out, but dark suit, dark tie. For men, and formal for women.
Attire.
Yes.
Formal attire.
Yes.
I saw you were searching for a word there.
you know, it's honestly, I have a hard time, even in military. Military is huge on uniforms, and I still have a difficulty, like, what's the equivalent? So dark suit, dark tie, what is the equivalent of that for formal wear for women?
High heels.
Honestly, I don't know.
Uncomfortable shoes.
Gown, if that's what gave me a clue. So, so one other event I think that the community would be interested in is on June 30th, we have our Red, White, and Blue Festival, which is open to everybody, and the installation will have access control procedures where individuals just need to have their valid driver's license to get on the post. But it is an event open to the community. We have two bands playing out in the middle of our parade field. It's basically to kick off our 4th of July weekend. So we got bands, we've got rides, carnival style rides. So there is a charge for rides and food, but there is a lot of free activities as well. And then once the sun goes down, we got what has traditionally been one of the better fireworks shows in the region. Usually it goes about 30 minutes.
Woohoo!
So yeah, so about June 30th, gates open at 4:30 and fireworks usually end up right around 10 o'clock.
Now, can folks bring in their own picnic basket for something like that since you have concessions?
You can bring in their own picnic basket, bring a blanket, bring an umbrella, just no glass.
Okay, gotcha.
And no lighting of fireworks on the parade field.
And no alcohol allowed on the base?
There is alcohol, yes, as long as it's not in a glass container.
All right, so bring it in your basket, make sure it's locked, yeah. Secured.
And there will also be beverages of choice being sold.
Adult beverages.
Yes.
All right, we have to qualify all those things, Chad. Well,
yeah.
I appreciate your time today.
Thank you very much.